Welcome back to another episode of History in Your Own Backyard. I'm your host, Susie Selick, here today in Waterville, Ohio, at the Ohio Electric Interurban Bridge. And I'm joined by Kathy Sako. Kathy, thanks for having us.
Thank you for coming.
So here at History in Your Own Backyard, we love history and want to get right into it. The who, the what, the why. Why was this bridge built? Can you talk to us about all those?
I'll do my best.
Okay.
Back in 1907, a group called the Lima and Toledo Traction Company got the ball rolling. They wanted to construct a bridge that would link Lucas County with Wood County. And so they hired the National Bridge Company out of Indianapolis to construct a bridge across the Maumee River. On it would run an electric trolley back and forth between Wood and Lucas counties. The bridge was completed in 1908, and it proved very popular for a very long time.
All right, Kathy, talk to us about the Roche de Boeuf and its historical significance.
Okay. Well, when the plans to build the bridge were first announced, there were a number of people, local people here. They called themselves the Maumee Valley Pioneer Association, and they were a little bit concerned because the bridge, the way it was planned, would be very near to the Roche de Boeuf. Now, that's a limestone outcropping that had been used for centuries and centuries by both the historic and the prehistoric Indian tribes in this area. It was a meeting place. Indian councils met there. Later on, the French fur trappers made use of it. It had historical significance, and it was considered also quite a beautiful outcropping. The name Roche de Boeuf means rock of beef in French.
In French.
Okay. And many people thought they named it that because originally it looked like an American bison moving up the river.
Okay. Cool. Yeah.
So people were concerned that maybe the construction of the bridge would somehow destroy the rock. They were not, you know, they were very concerned, but the bridge company said, no, we're going to be 6 feet away from the bridge. We're not going to harm it. In fact, when we run the trolley back and forth over the bridge, we will point that out as a focal point. And you know, tourists and visitors will love seeing this historic rock. As it turned out, they ended up blasting away a third of and using part of it as a support for one of their the bridge supports. So
Kathy, talk to us about like what made the bridge so significant at that time.
When this bridge was built, it was a revolutionary new kind of construction. The bridge was constructed of steel-reinforced concrete. That was the shell. The shell of the bridge was then filled in with earth. The design of the bridge was supposed to be reminiscent of the ancient Roman aqueducts. It was the longest earth-filled bridge in the world at the time that it was constructed. And so it was, you know, really state-of-the-art and something brand new. Unfortunately, I think that was part of the problem then. When the concrete began to crumble,
yeah.
You only had the earth inside that was beginning to fall out. So,
Kathy, can you talk to us about, you know, the purpose that the bridge served at that point?
Yes, it was simply a quicker way for people to get goods and people across the Maumee River faster than, you know, taking a canoe or something like that.
Right.
So it was quite revolutionary at the time. Electric trolleys were very popular.
Yeah.
And eventually the line that the bridge belonged to.
Yeah, the railroad line.
Yes, was connected all the way to Cincinnati. It was one of the longest trolley lines in America at that time. It went from the Toledo area all the way down to Cincinnati. It was called the Cincinnati and Lake Erie Line.
Okay. What railroad company owned it? Do you?
At first, of course, it was the Toledo Traction Company, but it changed names several times, and it changed ownership several times over the years. But I think probably the Cincinnati and Lake Erie line would be the one that you would most identify with it.
Okay, yeah. Right. Now, Kathy, talk to us about, you know, why the bridge diminished over time.
Oh, well,
really.
Of course. For a while, it was very popular. But then with the coming and the popularity of automobiles, the city of Waterville built its own bridge right in the heart of town across the Maumee River. And it welcomed automobile and truck traffic. And it was much quicker. It was more convenient rather than coming out here. And so over the years, it just gradually diminished in popularity. Also, over the years, there were some accidents on the electric bridge. There were some fires. And you put it all together, and it just kind of began to die a natural death.
Okay.
In the 1920s, it still was very popular. In fact, there was a race used to kind of advertise the bridge. And they actually raced. One of the trolleys was called the Red Devil. Some were named meteors and rockets. And that was stressing how fast people could travel on the bridge. The Red Devil had an average speed of about 90 miles an hour. And so they staged a race between the Red Devil trolley and an airplane. And the trolley won. It was clocked at 97 miles an hour, and it actually won the race with the airplane.
That's fun. So the bridge has not been used since 1939, right?
Yes, yeah, that's correct.
All right.
Well, I shouldn't say it hasn't been used at all.
Okay, right. With automobiles. And okay. Yeah, can you elaborate on that with the Ohio Department of Transportation and so on?
Yes. Gradually, they just decided to close the bridge down, and it just was not useful any longer because the other bridge accommodated so much more traffic. So it became kind of a magnet for teenagers going out to party and kids getting on there and fishing from it. It was considered somewhat of a hazard.
Mm-hmm.
So it really wasn't used for quite a long time. However, in 1941, when a big milk truck was crossing the bridge in Waterville, it collapsed into the Maumee River.
Okay. So all of a sudden, our electric interurban bridge is looking pretty useful, huh?
What are we going to do now?
Yeah.
So the Ohio Highway Department decided to lease the bridge. They paved it over. And all through the World War II years then, from 1941 until just after the war, they used the bridge for car and truck traffic.
So, Kathy, why has the bridge then been able to just be, like, unused and kind of, like, crumbling to pieces for all this time?
Well, it's not as though there weren't groups that were interested in preserving it. There really were through the years.
Okay.
At one point, they thought about turning it into a bike path, a pedestrian path across the river, or... at one point, one of the local garden clubs thought that they might be able to revive it and plant gardens and things to attract pedestrians, more or less.
Yeah.
But the problem was that the liability, the insurance cost, if something would happen, and the bridge was starting to crumble into the Maumee. So they thought, you know, if somebody gets hit by part of the bridge,
oh,
when
yeah,
they're canoeing under it or something. Mm-hmm. They just couldn't risk it. So gradually, it just, one plan after another fizzled. It was eventually put on the National Register of Historic Places.
Yeah.
And that was great. But as far as, you know, really a useful use of the bridge, nobody could think of anything. Mm-hmm.
Kathy, then, can you talk to us about then why the Ohio Department of Transportation wants to demolish it?
Okay, well, over the years, as I said, it attracted teenagers having parties out there. Eventually, they did cut off access at both ends of the bridge to discourage any pedestrians going on the bridge. The cost, though, to refurbish the bridge to bring it back to use would be, I think, in terms of $15 million is what we've been told. Just to demolish the bridge will cost about $2 million. So the Department of Transportation really is not interested in putting that kind of money into a bridge that is slowly collapsing into the Maumee River.
Of course. Okay, that makes sense. Well, this is the part of the interview that I typically would wrap up, but I want to know, is there anything special to you about this bridge? Anything memorable? Either you or the Historical Society can, you know, this is just a little chance to touch on that personally.
Sure. I'm interested in history, and of course the Historical Society is. The bridge has so much significance as far as the history around this area. It's scenic, it's beautiful. It has attracted photographers and artists from all over,
yeah,
who have used that bridge as a subject for their art. And just the fact that we have, you know, the Indian tribes in the area. We had General Anthony Wayne came into this area to get the Indians under control, I guess you would say, at the Battle of Fallen Timbers. It has so much significance, that and the Roche de Boeuf, that we just hate to see it disappear into history without some way of memorializing it.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, Kathy, it is absolutely breathtaking. I can see why so many artists have taken it from all around, right?
It's a beautiful bridge.
Yeah, all right. Well, Kathy, thank you so much for being able to meet with us today, be able to talk to us about this beautiful bridge, the Ohio Electric Interurban Bridge. Thank you again.
Okay.
Thank you for watching another episode of History in Your Own Backyard. I'm your host, Susie Selick, here today in Waterville, Ohio, at the Ohio Electric Interurban Bridge. And Kathy Sako, what a wonderful interview. Thank you so much for having us.
Thank you.
And remember,
travel slowly
and stop often. Bye for now.